How's everybody doing?
Wow.
Well, all right. Everybody stand up.
Is this calisthenics?
Everybody stand up. All right. Put your hand on your stomach. Close your eyes. Close your eyes. Don't look at me. And the reason why I ask you to put your hand on your stomach is so that you can become aware of who lives in you. As a habit, Christians, when we talk to God, when we pray, we lift up our hands towards Him. And that's cool with that. But I guess in these days, God is making us aware that we don't need to externalize Him. We need to internalize Him.
Amen.
And be aware that He lives in us. So just keep your hand on your tummy. And just close your eyes and just whisper to Him who lives inside of you. Tell Him, I love you.
I love you.
Tell Him, I love you. I want to love you more. Get deep breath. Sit down and relax. All right. Scripture says in Luke chapter 17, verse 21. In verse 20 and 21, it says, now at one point the Pharisees asked Jesus when the kingdom of God was coming. They were expecting the kingdom, which in the Greek is basileia, an establishment, a government type, when it was coming. He said to them, the kingdom of God is not coming with signs to be observed. So don't be looking for something around you. He said, nor will they say, look, here it is, or there. For indeed, the kingdom of God is where?
Within.
Within, right? Now, some translations say the kingdom of God is in your midst. And some said, the kingdom of God is within. So I'm like, it's a big difference within and in your midst. Within is within, and your midst is just trying to be politically correct.
Okay.
So I took the Greek, faithful Greek. And it says, the kingdom of God is entos. It's the Greek word entos. So I go look it up. And it means within, inside. So that clarified a little bit. Okay, so it's inside. Cool, that's fine. So based on that, okay, what God wants for us is for us to engage Him where He is. Engage Him and His kingdom right where He is. Okay? Because of theologies and because of belief systems, because for many years the body of Christ used a lot of Old Covenant language, we get into the habit of externalizing God. Okay? And we quote, and listen, it's not wrong. Okay? Don't freak out about it. Let's just, when you mention, quote something from the Old Testament, from the Hebrew Scriptures, from the Old Covenant, be aware that in Christ, it found its fulfillment.
That's right.
Those were shadows and types. We got the juice, okay?
Come on.
The juice.
Yes.
The
juice. So, the expression, we're going to the house of the Lord.
Right.
Okay. Sounds beautiful. Sounds cute. Okay? But the reality is that you cannot go to the house of the Lord. Because you are the house of the Lord.
Come on.
That's scripture.
Yeah.
We enter His courts with thanksgiving. That sounds beautiful. And it was great for David to do and to say that. His courts are within us. Because we are His temple.
Amen.
So that thanksgiving is permanent in our hearts. We don't enter. We are permanently united.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? With thanksgiving. Now, the scripture says that we have been joined to the Lord and we are one spirit with Him, correct?
Yeah, correct.
One spirit with Him, okay? There is no separation. There is no, well, you know, in the spirit I'm one with him, but in the flesh I'm, you know, far away from the Lord.
Yeah, right.
Nonsense, man. You died. The gospel is not an upgrade system. The gospel is cross with Christ. Boom, new creation, kainos. Mm. Now you live, now Christ lives in you. Now in him you live, in him you move, in him you have your being. You are united permanently and effortlessly, because it was all his idea. He did it for you.
That's right.
Okay? Now, in 1 Corinthians 3:16, Paul tells the Corinthians, okay? He tells them. Now, the Corinthians, who were they? They were pagans, right? They were pagans. And even in Corinthians, when he writes to them, he tells them, I got to give you milk, because you guys can't handle, you know, steak and potatoes. I got to give you Enfamil. I got to give you Similac. You guys are not ready. You guys are babies. Okay? And he tells them, who had no background, okay? The church in Corinth was mostly Greek. Corinth was like New York City.
Right.
Okay? Many cultures, many traditions. Some Jews, but there was mostly pagan. Okay? So they had no awareness of Jerusalem, the temple, God, and the prophets. No, they were these people that just came to know Christ and him crucified, as Paul preached. So he tells them, don't you know that you are God's temple? And the Spirit of God dwells in you? Don't you know that? They couldn't identify with that concept. But he tells them that because back in the days before Christ, right, and under the Old Covenant, we know that the presence of God, who he is, his Spirit, was everywhere, correct?
Mm-hmm.
David says, where shall I hide from your presence, right? If I go to heaven, you're there. If I go down to Sheol, you're there. If I go in the depths of the sea, you're there. You're everywhere. But yet we know that there was a temple, and there was a most holy place, and there was an ark, and in that ark, and upon it, right, who dwelt the presence of God. Okay, the Spirit of God had an address.
Right.
Okay? He had an address. Now, to understand that concept of the world and God's presence, it's like my phone is the universe, and I'm God. Tell me where I'm not.
Exactly.
Tell me where I'm not. Tell me where I'm not. You know what I mean? God is just, there's no place that, because the universe cannot contain him, so there is no place where he is not.
Amen.
Yet he chose to reside in the ark. Time goes by, the veil tears. Whoosh. God's presence now comes for the whole world to enjoy, right? So now the Holy Spirit comes upon believers to live in us permanently. He doesn't go, he doesn't come, he's not moody. You know what I mean? He's not like, oh, you must behave later.
Yeah.
And then we have to work him up with praise songs and everything. Come. And then he comes, all right, fine, I'm coming now. You know, and then you upset him and he's like, oh, later. Yeah. It doesn't work like that.
That's right, amen.
It doesn't work like that. He came to live 2,000 years ago, okay? He came upon the upper room and he made a big show. He made an entrance, okay? The one that was hovering upon the waters, upon creation, makes his world entrance.
Yeah.
Boom. Okay? He comes in. Tongues of fire. You know, it sounds like the world is falling apart. Everybody's like, something is going on over there. You know? And then they go and these guys are coming out and they're talking a different language. They're like, wow, that's pretty awesome. He made his big entrance to stay. To live in the heart of people. To live in us. Not to leave ever again.
Amen.
So, how do we engage this God? Because Holy Spirit is God, right?
Mm.
God is the Spirit.
Amen.
And those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So, how do we engage him? How? Why was he given to live in us? If we were meant to always externalize our worship, and externalize our prayer, and externalize our communion with God, then why put him inside of us? He should just stay way up there, and us from far away, oh, we pray, we pray. Why? Why put him inside? Why come and live in us? That's just that was God's heart. In the beginning, God creates a being named Adam, and God doesn't give him a Bible, an altar, a set of worship songs. God hangs out with him in the garden. God puts himself in Adam. And if you go into the Hebrew, you know, spirit is ruach, is breath.
Yeah.
God creates Adam, and some of the Jewish mystics believe that Adam went like this. When God stepped into him, Adam goes, oh,
yeah.
And then, oh, and now he was a living being.
Yeah.
In the same essence as God. And now God lived next to him, but also that same essence as God is inside of him. Okay? So then what happens? The temple is shadow and type of our reality. Okay? We have become that vessel where God lives. We have become it.
Yep.
You are it. He doesn't go. You don't have to call him. Let me just give you the, you know, 411. You do not have to call God.
Amen.
He lives in you. He's waiting for you to engage him here where he lives. Hmm. Internally. Okay? Right there. He's right with you right there. You, the new creation, Holy Spirit, whoop, total union. He's right in there. Okay. So intimacy has to be your primary desire about everything. What can I say? Many times we express to God that we are hungry and thirsty for him. And now, that's the beautiful paradox about walking with God. Jesus said in John 6, I believe, he says, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never hunger, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. So the hunger and thirst area, satisfied. Satisfied. And when I was thinking, you know, I was thinking, Lord, how do I explain this? You know, it's that we are satisfied and you don't lie. So I cannot be hungry or thirsty for you. How do I explain that thing that I just want you, you know? I want you. He's like, it's desire, son. It's desire.
Yeah.
Before you marry your wife, he's like, hey, you were hungry and thirsty for her. You know? I'm like, okay. But after you married her, after you were united to her, now you desire her. Right? You can only desire something that you already have had. Mm. Before that, you don't know. You know what I mean? So it's like, ah. Mm. So he's like, build a pathway for desire. Build it in your life. That desire has to be burning within us. Okay? Many times you say to the Lord, I love you. Who says I love you to God?
Amen.
A few of you don't, that's cool. Now my question to you is, how do you know that you love him? How do you know that you love him? Hmm. We know he loves us. We know that. Right? He loved us first. How do you know that you love him? Hmm. Jesus tells us. Yes.
I was just going to say, I don't want to disappoint him. I don't want to do anything that would hurt him.
No, and that's beautiful. How do you know that you love him? When you say to him, I love you, how do you know that you love him? Yes. Correct. You can feel his love. Yes. How do you know that you love him? That's interesting, right? Yes.
You obey his word.
That's beautiful. How do you know that you love him? Because there are people who are decapitating individuals, and they will tell you, I love God.
Yeah.
Right? Yes, sister. By your works, okay.
Works, that negative works, but the fruit of the
spirit. Okay, I love all these suggestions. You have people in other religions who worship 30,000 gods and say, I love God. Yet they are deceived. Now, I know we're believers here, but how do you know that you can say to God, I love you, and not be deceived? Yes? Pardon? Correct. He's not a liar. Correct. How do you know? You see, it's hard to come up with that answer. Because if we're honest, how do we know that we love God? I don't know. I just love him. Can I explain it? No. How do I know? I don't know. I just have to trust my feelings, and I have to trust my heart, and I have to trust my emotions that I love him, right?
Yeah.
I heard somebody say once, we can be deceived sometimes if we think that we love him and we're fooling ourselves sometimes. But when you desire him, you don't have to know. You can be in your heart, I love God. But you know what? I want you. I desire you. I know you live in me. And that's what I tell him, okay? Up here on stage is when I bear my everything, you know? You know, it's like, I want you, and I love you, and I desire no one but you. I just don't know how to go about it, but you know that I want you.
Amen.
You know what I mean? Now, that is a sign to him, like, oh, he wants me. And he gets all happy, you know, because we want him.
Yeah.
And then he teaches you the way to make yourself available for him to rock your world.
Mm.
We love him and we want him not from a position of absence, you know what I mean? Not from a position of being distant, but from a position of being already united to him.
Right.
You're already one with him, you know? His heart is beating and your heart is beating. You know, if in the spirit you were to look at your hands, you would see nail marks on your hands because you were crucified with him 2,000 years ago. As a matter of fact, humanity was crucified with Christ, okay? And now you live. You're a resurrected being. You're alive because he lives. It is Christ who lives in you. A Bible translation says about Galatians 2:20, it says, I have been crucified with Christ, yet I no longer live, but it is now Christ using my body. To give you a deeper understanding of the language, it is now Christ using my body. It's Christ wearing me as a glove. You know, Christ has put me on like a skin. Everybody's too quiet. I feel like I'm in a theological seminar. Just kidding, guys. So, how do we engage God? Here. How do we do it? Okay. Again, you are powerful and you are free to disagree with me. And that's beautiful. You're powerful and free to pursue your way of connecting and your way to engage God and engage his kingdom in you. Okay. But this is my way and the way of many old folks from the 1600s.
Personal friends of yours?
No, not yet. Unless I time for everyone. Okay, so build a pathway to engage with him. Build a pathway to encounter with him within you. Begin by eliminating from your vocabulary language that speaks of separation or that speaks of lack.
Right.
Okay? What language is that? And I am guilty of also growing in my Christian walk with that language, okay? And especially songs, like worship songs, okay? I grew up singing worship songs, and now I'm like, what the heck was I singing? I sound like an orphan.
Yes, come on.
You know? Yeah. Wait a minute. An orphan, if Paul were to walk in this place where I'm singing, he would say, oh, poor people, they don't know Jesus. Because <You know? laughs> a lot of the Christian songs you know, mm-hmm. sound like that. Number one, you know, so, you know, not everybody got that. So,
yeah.
Anyway, so we need to change our vocabulary. We got to stop this language of separation and this language of lack, okay? For example, I love it and I understand when people say, God showed up, okay? You see, God showed up. It's like me saying, I showed up. For me to show up, it means I was absent from a place. I was absent from a place. In this case, God doesn't live in places, per se. Like in the Old Testament, his presence is all over the earth. But now he lives where?
In us.
In us. Okay? No more in Jerusalem. No more in the temple. Now we have become his dwelling place. Right? So the language of welcoming him. I know what we mean. I know the paradox. Okay? Because sometimes we engage his presence so good and juicy, right? And you feel like your spirit just like, boom, right? And it goes right through your skin. And you feel like 10 feet tall and powerful. And you feel like, whoa, he showed up. I'm sorry, he didn't. He just began to be expanded from being in you, right? Now, we talk also the language of outpouring. There was an outpouring 2,000 years ago, okay? He came into the world. He hasn't left. He lives where now? In us. When you go out there and you share Jesus and you give a prophetic word and you get people healed, you are a walking outpouring. You are a walking revival. You understand what I'm saying?
Right.
The language, even the language of outpouring, is like at one time God said, they had too much Holy Spirit now. Let me suck some of it up. All right. Later on, when they start singing more songs, later on, when they start praying more, later on, when they start fasting more, later on, when they start, they're going to put some more. Oh, yeah, they're doing it. All right, here you go. That's not God.
That's right.
That is a language that humans have, the church has devised to try to explain periods of time when they woke up, when they became aware to the reality of Christ in us, the hope of glory, all the time.
Right.
So when believers get together and they start saying, you know what? Wow, he lives in us. Wow. Hey, the sick and healed. This is happening. They become to get stirred up.
Right.
Stirred up. And they do it more. And they go to the streets because, hey, stuff is working. Wow, wow. What do we call that? Revival.
Exactly.
We have always been revived. Yeah. If you were not revived, you wouldn't be a believer. Hmm. He lives in you. You can't be dead. Things that are dead need to be revived.
Right.
And if believers are dead, well, they got more things to worry about than just a few songs. You are revived. We walk revived. We are walking revival.
That's right.
When we start to be bold and just manifest what's in us, mm-hmm. it's when people notice. It's when Charisma Magazine notices and they begin to write articles with revival. Sounds nice, is the language that has been used. Mm. Okay? And there are times that since that's the language that people use, it's okay to use it. Because how do you communicate with someone if you don't speak their language, right? What else? Oh, yeah. So, we need to engage God in us, and then we need to build upon it. Okay? What do you mean by that? Okay, let me explain to you. And let me say with a testimony, okay? One time, a couple of years ago, I took Maddie to soccer practice. Okay? We went to the park. I took him, he was out there practicing. I sat on the little chair, and I'm just there hanging out, you know. And I'm there, and I began to listen to a song by a group called Throne Room, the Throne Room Company. Pretty cool music, you know. So I'm there listening, and I'm enjoying it. And he's playing, and I'm enjoying it. And I start to engage God, and I close my eyes. And I turn inwards, and I just begin to talk to him, and I just get lost in it, right? Suddenly, I'm awake and I'm standing here, and there is a white marble road, and there is like an ocean that the water is so still it looks like glass. And in front of me is the Lord, and he goes to me like this. So I take his hand, and he starts pulling me, and we come up to the gate of like a city that was walled, big white walls. I get all the way there, the gates open, he disappears. So I'm like, I look at the wall on this side, on that side. I walk in, and I keep on going in, and I see streets. And you know the old New York streets, like made out of bricks? Mm-hmm. Okay, they were gold. Okay, wow. It was made out of gold, big gold bars.
Wow.
And there were sidewalks, and there were buildings, like three-story buildings. And there were people in white hanging out by the window. There were people passing, riding a bike. And those were dog lovers, okay? Don't judge me. There were dogs on the street, okay? And they were just beautiful, and everybody's happy. There were groups of people in the corner, and they're gathered together, and they're talking, and it was like festive. You know when you have like a parade in town, and people are just hanging out together? And it was festive. It was nice. It was good. So I take a step forward, and suddenly it's like I go like 100 miles an hour to the center, and I'm like in a park setting. There's people walking, it's beautiful. And I was like, I'm at the park, okay, with my eyes closed, and all this is happening to me, okay? And then after that, I was like so in awe of what's going on, and I open my eyes, I get distracted, and I'm like, wow, man, that was amazing, you know? And that happened to me, that's a beautiful experience, and that stayed in my mind and in my heart. And then one time I heard a brother say, when you had an experience with God, okay, when you engaged Him and you had a beautiful moment with Him, okay, you know how when you haven't seen a friend in like 6 months, and hey, how you doing? Hey, how's it going? You meet your friend. You don't start by introducing yourself again and going to square one. You don't do that.
Right.
You pick up right where you met last. Mm. Well, when you engage God, okay, there is a process, a ladder process of growth by engaging the previous encounter you had with Him, and then you build on that. So when I heard that one time, I'm like, all right, let's put it to use, you know? Mm-hmm. Now, months have passed, and I hadn't done any of that. So months passed, and I don't remember where I was, okay? Maybe I was laying in my bed. I don't know. Do you remember, honey? Oh, okay. Thank you, sweetie. So anyway, I'm somewhere, and so I began to be like, okay, Lord, I remember that day. So I began to engage again with my heart, okay? Remember, everything has desire and honor. So I began to desire to be in that place again. And Lord, I honor that you took me, and I thank you, and I want it again, you know? So I began to engage with Him. Internally, outside I'm just like quiet, inside I'm just with Him. So then suddenly, I'm right where I left off. Hmm. I'm right at the end of the park, I'm by the park, and I'm like, this is great, you know? So then I go across the park, and it continues, and there's more walls, and it's like, it looked like a city, huge, but a city. So then I turn around, and then I look, and I go back to the gate where I entered in. And then I see the marble where I was, but then I see that it goes and it connects to many other places and many other cities, like the one that I was in. Hmm. And I was like, wow, that's pretty cool. I don't know if that's in the Bible or not, but it was pretty cool, you know? So anyway, and then I was so in awe again that I just opened my eyes and I was like, wow, Lord, you know, that's pretty awesome. What I'm trying to say with that is that engage them often. Okay, this is more of a practical talk about it. Engage them often, and don't start from scratch. Mm. Start from the last place where you left with Him. The last place that you were with Him. Start from there. Recall it. Talk to Him about it. Okay? As a matter of fact, recall the sounds. Recall the smells. Recall what you were hearing at that moment. You were hearing angels. You were hearing children. You were hearing anything. You re-engage that. Okay? Okay. So, I'm going to read. From Hebrews 12. Now, this is in the book of Hebrews. They're not sure if Paul is a writer or not. But he tells them, okay? You know, Hebrews is about shadow to reality, right? Shadow types to reality in Christ. So he tells the Hebrews, worldwide Hebrews, he tells them where they are now. Okay, with us beautiful Gentiles, okay? So Paul says, if it's Paul, says in 22, but you have come to Mount Zion, the city of the living God, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to myriads of angels, to the assembly, to the congregation of the firstborn, who are enrolled in heaven, and to God, the judge of all, and to the spirits of the righteous who have been made perfect, and to Jesus, the mediator of a new covenant, and to the sprinkled blood that speaks of something better than Abel's dust. What is he saying to them? He's saying, we have come to this place. We are in the center of the Twinkie. We are in it. You know what I mean? We are in it because of Christ. There is no ascent, no climbing up into his glory. It's all in you.
Yes.
It's just engage and wake up. Engage, wake up. Engage and wake up. Okay? So we're going to do... Should I do this? No, there we go. Now... In a practical sense, okay? In a practical sense. Now, I had you put your hands on your tummy, right? Okay. That's something that I developed with the Lord in my own thing with him, right? I said, when we're in public, I said, I don't want to be all, you know, emotional about it. So I say, our thing, now I'm telling you all that, right? So now you're going to see me when I'm like this, like, whoo. So I developed with him a thing that I said, you know what? When I put my hands here, how about between you and I, it's like me hugging you. And nobody knows but just you and I.
Aww.
And he's like.
Everybody.
Aww. Hey, I'm doing my soul here, okay?
Awesome, man.
You know, so that's like, when I put my hand here, it's like if I'm hugging you, okay? And he's like, okay. So guess what happens? When out of the blue, you're just like, and you just focus on him who lives in you.
Yeah.
You are his temple, and he's in the holy place, and you just wrap your arms around him. What happens when you do that? What do you think happens? He's like, ah. And if you can stay on your feet, it'd be a good thing, okay? If your legs go wobbly, that's what happens most of the time, okay?
Right.
If you start just weeping, that's what happens most of the time, okay? Right. If your heart just feels overwhelmed and overtaken and conquered and melting inside you, that is what happens, okay? You don't have to worry about your imperfections. Engage them in love. Engage them inside of you, and the junk falls off. You don't have to worry about it. You engage them. The junk falls off. Okay? So we're going to do a little activation. Mm-hmm. And what we're going to do is, let's all stand up.
Okay.
Okay. Now, we're all family here, so we don't look silly to each other. But what I want us to do, right, is I want us to be aware of him living in us, right? Not out there, not in the third heaven, not far away. In us, okay? And I want us to hug him, okay? Hug him. And not that we hug, you know, hey, how you doing? God bless you. No. You know what I mean, right?
Of course. Yeah,
of course.
I want you to hug him the way you would hug your, if you're married, the way you would hug your spouse.
Right.
Okay? If you haven't seen them in 2 weeks, mm-hmm. with your all your being wanting to be in contact. Okay? We're gonna do that. We're gonna hug him because he lives in us. Mm. Remember that. In us. So we're going to hug him with all of our love, all of our passion, okay? And we're going to tell him, I love you. Mm. And if even I don't know what loving you is, I want to love you more. I desire you.
Wow.
We're going to do that, okay? And as we do that, I'm going to play a recording. We're going to play a recording of a prayer as we do this activation, okay? Now, don't allow yourself to be distracted, okay? Don't think it's just foolishness, okay? This is you engaging your lover, okay? Engaging the one who lives in you, okay? The one who takes your breath away, mm-hmm. the one who just like rocks you, okay? So, okay, so let's do that. Let's right now just center yourself in Him, Christ in you, the hope of glory. Just take your arms and just put them around yourself because you are hugging Him, because you and Him are one. And just hug Him. And just close your eyes if that's what helps you to be centered and to be less distracted. And just love Him. And just, in your mind, just focus on Him being in you and tell Him words of love. Father, I love you. I love you. I love you and I want to love you more. I just don't know how to go about it. Mm. But I desire you. And so before I play this activation, let me warn you. You may go places, okay? You may go places. You may have visions, or you may interact. You may see Him, you may see angels. What you usually do, but you're going to engage Him, okay? So here we go.
The realm where death dwells, where His presence is inside of you. I'm going to get you to pray in tongues, and I'm going to get you to begin to focus there. Because what I want you to do is to take your spirit and your soul, the same way as you would hug your husband or wife or your children. And I want you to begin to embrace it with purpose and by your choices. And so let's just start praying in tongues. Father, today I turn towards your presence that dwells inside of me. Father, thank you that you live in me and that you are in spirit. Thank you, Lord, that it is your presence. Lord, it's spirit to spirit that I can embrace your glory. Lord, it's spirit to spirit that I can touch your presence. Today, Lord, I take my soul and with purpose, I turn my soul to embrace your presence. Lord, I turn my soul to God's presence. Lord, to be able to love in your presence. Father, today, Lord, I turn towards your glory. I turn towards your glory that dwells in me, your omniscience, your omnipresence, and your omnipotence. Father, I turn towards that which is within the veil of my spirit. I turn
Now slowly increase the intensity of praying in the spirit. Make it a little bit more violent.
Yamrota sakriya mananare. Lord, I come to the King of Mercy, I come to the King of Grace. I ask you, Holy Spirit, come down tonight on me, Lord. Grant me what I'm supposed to be. I am yours.
Lord, we want you. We know we have you, Lord. We know we are united to you. After this is over, you did it all. But we just want you, Lord. We desire you. We want to know what you like. We want to know everything that you like. We want to know everything about you. Everything.
Hold him.
Find the one whom your soul desires and don't let him go. Feel free to love. Father, I love you. Jesus Christ, my Lord, I love you. Holy Spirit, I love you. Tonight, we're going to have an encounter with the Lord like we have never experienced before tonight.